is on creating a separate website for a full version versus a desktop version, and what are some things you can do to get around the issue of having duplicated content. You know, you might want the same list of links on the same page, and why you'd even do it in the first place, and all that sort of thing. So what we're going to look at is we are going to look at taking our code that we had last time, now that we have assured that our function works, that shows us the class. We've defined three classes in our application. We've defined a mobile class, a desktop class, and a tablet class. Now that we know that, we can then go in and we can actually make our page look the way we want to in those environments. If you remember, we said something along the lines of we wanted the mobile version to look like a jQuery mobile application. We wanted the full version to include the video, and we wanted the tablet version not to include the video. And no video on the mobile version as well, might as well. So, again, you would have to do this on a server that has WURFL. So, what I did is I put this on the LC server. And I think the point that we left at last time was if we got that function working to where it would tell me if I was on a desktop, a tablet, or a mobile device. So we have some debug code in there that has information about the device, and it's smart enough to know that it is that. All right, this is one where they, you know how they, in football they say we're going to review the tape. I got to look, because I swear last time it said tablet true for the desktop. Because that's why I rearranged the if statement. That's what I'm thinking too. It's like maybe I'm getting confused with my problems. The tablet then should say that it's a tablet, and my phone should say that it is a phone. Cleverly enough. Sure enough, the tablet says it's a tablet. A little hard to read, and the phone says it's a phone. So now that we have that, we can actually write some code to take advantage of that. And we can take advantage of it two different ways. We can take advantage of it to include the content that we want to see or don't want to see. And we can write it to apply different styles. In some respects, keep in mind that this doesn't necessarily beat our, our queries, our media queries in the CSS. But we can sort of mix or match and use this. In other words, the CSS I don't need to apply with a media query because I have a different mechanism to know it's a mobile device. All right? As opposed to in our media queries, we applied the mobile style sheet based on some media query. We don't really need to do that now, all right? Because again, the WURFL database tells us that it's a mobile device, and as such, we can then go and do that. So let's go and look at the code here. All right. This, if you remember, was my debugging code that I put in there. I'm going to get rid of that page. Actually, I'll rename it to debug, just in case I would ever need it again. And I'll rename my regular index back to that. Oops. Back to index. And I actually did change that a bit. We're not having three Booleans. We are simply having one class variable that can have a value of desktop, mobile, or tablet. I'm going to use this syntax for commenting because I want to comment a bunch of lines. Oops. I think this works in PHP. We'll find out. All right, so I can go in here and say if class equals desktop, or class equals tablet. If you remember, the way we distinguished between these two is that they have the same look, they're just going to have slightly different content. It's not going to include the video on the tablet, where it will include the video on the full version. The pipes, the two vertical lines, represent an OR. So with an OR condition and an IF statement, if either of the two halves of it are true, then the whole if statement is true. So if the class is desktop or if the class is tablet, if it's one of those two, either of those two, then we're going to display this enhanced style sheet. Otherwise, we're going to display the jQuery mobile style sheet. We then have the catch for IE to let it handle HTML 5. We then have this. And here again, I want to include this content. If it's a tablet or a desktop version. And this over here, I only want to include if we're talking about the desktop version. So interestingly enough, the hardest part of this, you know, the hardest part, even if I was on my game last time, would have been creating that function to define the classes. Once you define the classes, it's pretty straightforward. You just have a series of if statements to say, under this condition, apply this style sheet or show this content. And again, in a nutshell, that's what we're doing. We have if statements here to say what style sheet to apply. We then have if statements here to say what content to include. On the full version and the tablet version, we include that second paragraph. On the desktop version, we include that video. So let's save it and make sure that this works. All right. Let me connect an FTP over to that server. And I will copy the index over there. Again, I could go through the trouble of installing WURFL on here, but instead I'm just going to use a server where I know it is. Now let's go and look at it. All right. There's the full version, and unfortunately I left some of my debug code in. So we'll go and get rid of that. I think I got rid of it, I just don't think I copied it over. It was in here, in the includes. Yeah. All right, something doesn't look right here with the CSS. We'll come back to that in a minute.
Please welcome the Modern Jazz Quartet.
That's one thing that we'll come back to that one, because it doesn't look like the CSS is correct. Let's view this in Firefox just for giggles, or Chrome for that matter. That'll give us some insight whether the problem is with the full version or... All right, it looks good in Chrome, so this seems to be an IE compatibility issue. So, in one respect, that's good. We know what we're up against, and we can go in and we can figure it out. I would assume if we view it in Firefox, that we'd get the same thing. Of course, I don't think Firefox is installed here. Let's see. No, I don't see it. That's okay. All right. So, it's working in the... in Chrome, but there's apparently some IE compatibility issues, so we'll file that away. Let's view this in our mobile device and in our tablet and see if we get the results that we're expecting. All right. On the tablet, we're getting the results that we're expecting, even though there's a couple of little issues. Might not be able to see this. Let's zoom in a bit on it. There is no video here. If you look, right there is the actual link. So the code does show the link if the video is not to be displayed, which is exactly what we want to have happen. That's what we have in our code. If we're on the full version, if we're on the desktop version, we embed the video. Otherwise, we put a link to the video. So that is working the way that I would want. And that will take me over to the YouTube app and play it. All right. Now, let's go and see what it looks like on a mobile phone. If we did everything correctly, we should get this to have the jQuery mobile look and feel. And sure enough, thought we had it. We have the jQuery mobile look and feel. And again, there's a link to the video down there. But the video is not embedded. And it has a different styling. Now, the point of this is again, we've expanded, even though we just expanded a little bit. But we expanded from our earlier example where we had the yes or no question of, is this a mobile device or not? All right. And we've expanded even beyond the area of media queries to where we can ask a lot of questions about the device. All right? We can ask, for example, if it's a phone. All right? We can ask the manufacturer for it. Think of the customized content that you can give and you can provide based on some of these other attributes. Let's look at the capabilities in WURFL and maybe play around a bit with them so we can customize it. For one thing that we notice here, is I do have a little test program that we can look at. This knows, for example, the brand name is Microsoft. All right, let's see what the brand name is on this guy. This one, the brand name says correctly that it is a Motorola. All right. And this one, it's also Motorola, so I'm guessing it will say the same thing. And sure enough, it does. The tablet says Zoom. The phone, which might be a little hard to see, says it's the Droid X2. So we can get really sophisticated. We know we can know the actual device that the person's on, and we can write some slick logic for ads or something like that, or downloads. If we know they're on Windows, we can make a download link be to a Windows download of an application. If we know that they're on Android, we can send them to the Android store for that. All based on the particular environment that they're running. Let's take a look at the list of the capabilities, see if we can find something fun to play with. Their help document has a list of all the capabilities that we can ask. We can ask for the brand name, we can ask for the model name, we can ask for the marketing name, and so on. Is it wireless? Is it a tablet? What kind of device are you using to pointing? All right. Does it have a physical keyboard? Version of the browser, operating system, all these things. One of them that we have is we have the region that this is, the market region for this device. And we can use that, we have the potential to use that for localization. Whether or not they have AJAX support. Even the kind of markup that's used, XML support level. They have three levels. And so on. Resolution width. So we could ask for the resolution width and customize the page that way if we chose to. Does it have a cellular radio? So the bottom line is we can ask a lot of questions of this, and we can do all these things to customize our web page. All right? And based on the parameters that we find here, we can either change the actual content that we display or change the way that it's being presented and shown. Do you have any questions about this? Okay. All right. Let's go then and let's just for demonstration purposes, let's make a test page that we can go and we can experiment with the different capabilities. Some of the things we've done, some of the things we haven't done before. So we'll just make this be our WURFL experiment. We'll keep the CSS the same. We will get rid of the body and we'll add some of the things in that we can do. All right. First of all, let's put the link on there to determine if it is a phone or not. Now, we had logic in the textbook, but I think we can actually do this simpler. So let's Google again and get the capabilities. They have these separated into different classes. One of the things that we can pick on here is that whether it has a radio or not. So, we have our three classes. That's going to do our styling for us. We could do some content, and maybe we will do some content. But in addition to our three classes, we may look at other capabilities. So the classes that we're going to define are going to be kind of used like in the broadest sense. In other words, we're going to use that to style the page. We're going to decide which like blocks of code and which elements we want on the page. But we can then customize further by looking at more specific capabilities. So, for example, the one that we've seen before is an if statement to look at the capability of whether it has a radio or not. Now, if this is something that we were going to have a lot of things for, all right, like if we were going to do a bunch of things, we might make another class for mobile device, mobile phone, and we might test this up in there. But if we're going to just sort of one or two things with this, we could just embed this code right in our PHP page. So again, a couple different ways we could do this that would be reasonable. So what we can do is, if there is a phone, we can create a link and actually use the syntax so that on the phone, if we press it, it will dial. Now, one thing I want to make sure that you're clear about, and let me know if you have any questions, is that given that PHP is a mix of HTML stuff and PHP code, it can be very confusing sometimes the way this works, where you start an if statement in PHP, then you have a block of HTML code, and then you end the if statement. Is that pretty clear to you, or does that look goofy? Yeah. The key thing I would say is format your code well so that things line up. That's your big catch for doing that. The other thing you could do, of course, to help is you could take these little snippets and make little functions for them, like display phone. And in fact, let's go and do that. Let's make a PHP function that will display the phone. So I can go in. At the bottom of the page with this, and I can create my function now the nice thing is I could put this now in an include file, and anywhere where in my application where I wanted to display the phone, I could call this, assuming that it was set up for the page was set up with WURFL in mind. What that allows us to do then is we can simply make function calls and we don't have all our code cluttered up. We don't have the main line of code cluttered up with all these dumb, hard-to-read functions. If you've done work in a .NET framework, the .NET framework, if you use Visual Studio with it, it takes you down a path. All right? It does a good job at making your code separate from your GUI elements. And it really points you in the right direction and really encourages some good habits. You get none of that in PHP. All right? With PHP, you can write the worst code imaginable. And there's nothing, you know, if you're using a plain text editor like this, and even if you're not, there's nothing in the PHP framework that sort of nudges you in the direction of following good coding practices. That's why you have to do this on your own. So as far as breaking things down to functions, breaking things down so it's logical, and all that responsibility for that lies largely with you. So let's go in and let's save this and copy it over to our FTP server and verify that it indeed works. I didn't want to do localhost. Ah. Also get rid of the style sheet because I don't want that fancy background. I get an error. Undefined variable requesting device. All right. You're probably too smart to by the old, I made this mistake on purpose to illustrate a point. But although I didn't do it on purpose, this brings up an interesting thing. Let's look at the error message it's given me. Undefined variable requesting device. All right, so it doesn't know this function requests this function over here uses requesting device, and it's telling me it doesn't know what that is. Now, if we look at our include file, we'll see, it looks like there is a variable called requesting device. So how come this function doesn't recognize that? This function doesn't recognize it because global variables for PHP are handled differently than almost any other programming language. All right. Are you familiar with global variables versus local variables? Yeah. Global variable is a variable that can be used like anywhere within the object, within the page, and so on. Most programming languages work like this. If we have, let's say if this were a JavaScript application. If we had a script tag here, if I had a script tag here, it said var I equals 1, then I had a function. And I said alert I. If this were JavaScript, it would look and say this variable I was declared outside of any function. Therefore, that variable exists anywhere on the page. So if I did an alert I, I'd get the value of this variable. So assuming nothing changed, then I get the value of 1. All right? That's the way most programming languages work. You know, think in Java. If Java, if you had an instance variable, they'd call them an instance in that case as opposed to a global, but if you had an instance variable that was an integer and you set it to 1 or 10 or whatever, anywhere within your functions, any of your functions could use that variable because it's global. It's defined outside of any functions. So therefore, it can be used throughout the class. So like when we saw those examples today of like the number of lives in the spot-on game and all those things. All those things were defined outside of a function. Therefore, they could be accessed within any function. PHP is the exact opposite of everyone else. Variables are assumed local no matter what unless you specify otherwise. So, if I have a block of PHP code, remember, How do you declare a variable in PHP? You don't. All right? You don't. You just start using it. So there's really no way to declare it. So if I declare an I over here, and I have a function and somewhere in here I do something with the variable I, thinking, hey, I declared I outside, therefore it must be global. Wrong. It would work that way in JavaScript, but it won't work that way in PHP. So it's kind of like the reverse. In JavaScript, if I wanted this I to be a local variable, I'd have to declare it in here as well. So I'd declare it in both places. Then it would know that inside the function I meant the local I, not the global I. With PHP, the assumption always is that the variables are local unless you explicitly say they're global. So how do you explicitly say a variable is global? At the beginning of the method, you say global and put the name of the variable. So what I need to do in this case is go in here and grab this requesting device variable. And in my function for display phone, I need to say global requesting device. So now it will know when I refer to requesting device, I'm not talking about some local variable, local to that function. I'm talking about the one that was declared outside of the function. And this should work. Let me go and save it. And copy it. Whoops. And now if we look, it works, because now it knows to use that. And it knows, of course, because we are on a desktop, there's no phone associated with this, so I get the no phone function. All right, on the tablet, interestingly enough, the tablet has a call me link. So it must return true for that. Now, how can we fix that? Let's make sure the phone works before we fix it. Probably a number of ways we could fix it. But we already know for a tablet, probably doesn't have a phone to it. The actual phone does work as well. I can't see that. And it has the call me link. Well, I can just enhance my if statement here to do an and. Okay, not this one, but this one. So I could say if it's a wireless device and the class is mobile, then display the link for the phone. That will keep it from displaying on the tablet. Oh, that shouldn't be his wireless device. Maybe that's the problem. Has cellular radio. I copied and pasted it incorrectly, or I forgot to change it. So well, let's go and try that before we even put that in there. That one still works. All right. I'm still getting a statement saying that that one is a phone. So let's go in and we'll add that code that I was going to add anyhow. Now, the and for a condition is the two ampersands. So I would have to say and class equals mobile. Now, if I ran this as it is, it's going to give me an error. What error is it going to give me if I run this? Actually, the error that it will give us is, remember, class is defined outside of this function. Therefore, it's not a global variable, so I would have to declare it as a global variable. Yeah, it is. It is. Really, though, there'd be those that argue that you shouldn't be using global variables anyhow. All right? What would be your way around that? How could you do this without using global variables? you could do that. The other thing you could do is you could pass it as an argument. So I could do this. Pass an argument of RD and of C. All right. And I could do RD, if RD get capability, has cellular radio, and $C. And then when I called this, function, I would have to call it with, what was that called, requesting device? And class. Alright. Then everything will be okay and I don't have to worry about global variables. So in a way that's sort of the punchline of this one. You know, global variables are a pain, but you kind of get around that pain by the fact that you really ought not be using global variables. The problem with global variables is you can lose track of where they get changed. All right? So if you don't make them available as global variables, you have very tight control of where they get changed. All right? Now, I hope this still works. Let's go and move the code up. All right, that part works. This one works. And can't see it. That one works. And let's go. The tablet now correctly reports, and I know it's really hard to read, that there's no phone to it. Oops. Tablet says no phone. All right. So, we can look at other capabilities as well. Like I said before, we can look and based on the browser or based on the manufacturer, we could actually, again, configure links, configure ads, anything along those lines to make that. Let's go and let's do something based on manufacturer. Let's see here. All right, we can pull the brand name from this. Let's go and let's just simply display the brand name for this. And again, I can go in and I can make a neat function that says display brand. And I can make the function simple, or I could make it more involved. Right now, I'm simply going to display the brand. But I could test this variable. And based on the value of this variable, based on the value of this variable, I could show something. Underscore name. And I'm getting an error on it, on the tablet, so let me look. Oh, I forgot the closing curly bracket. It tells me that that's a Microsoft device. This tells me that it's Motorola. So again, based on that, you can do all kinds of cool things. All right. Let's see, just for laughs, what if I pull it up from my laptop, what it says. And it tells me Firefox. So it again, the interesting that you get slightly different, the database contains slightly different values depending on the kind of device it is and so on. The point is, the point of all this, and the thing that we want to keep in the back of our mind is, less important are the exact details of what we use, but the thing to remember is that we can do so much more by using a database such as this. We can do so much more than simply saying, is it mobile or not? We can do a lot more. We can really, you know, do our high power user agent detection. Whereas the script that we looked at initially in this class gave a very binary, yes, it's mobile, no, it's not. Here we cannot just find out the nature of the device, but we can find out tons of information about it, and we can use that in our app. All right. One of the other things that we can do, I'll have to look at the schedule, is we can tell location, where the person is. All right. And that's very valuable. So far in this class, we've looked at creating mobile web pages that were essentially just web pages, right? They may look like the desktop page, they may look differently than the desktop page. But what we really want to do is we really want to write a good mobile experience. And not simply take our web page as it exists and make it work on a mobile device. So, the WURFL database is the first step in that direction. because we can find out a lot about the device, and we could do things like incorporate the phone into our application if we needed. The next big thing that we're going to do to make this more of a true mobile experience as opposed to just a web page that appears on a mobile phone is looking at geolocation. All right, you can imagine all kinds of uses for geolocation. Imagine, for example, you know, on Elsie's website they have a map that shows you where all the buildings are. Well, that's cool, you know, that may help you out. And maybe if you brought it up on your mobile device, that would be useful. You could look at it. But how much more valuable would it be if you had a... How much more valuable would it be if you had a map on your mobile device that not only showed you a map of the campus, but showed you a little pointer that said where you are? All right? So in other words, I want to find the UP building. I can look at the map and say, is it over there? Is it over there? Find a little pointer that says where I am, and then maybe click something that says, okay, I want to get to the UP building, and it showed me a little icon where the UP building is. Then I can walk, and if I'm going the wrong way, I notice I'm getting farther away from my destination. That's an example of really making it a mobile experience instead of just a web page that just happens to be displayed on a phone. So that's one of the next things we're going to work at, is look on geolocation. And we'll pick that up on next week. All right. Any questions? All righty.